The days is numbered. Oh. Woe to Babylon, the days are numbered. So, you know, and dealing with the end times. Yes, we're in the end times, but let's understand whose end times it really is, and whose new beginnings this really is, by the grace of the true God and Father of our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMoshiach. And this is a continuation of the teachings of His Imperial Majesty. But what we want to touch on is look a little bit, continue with what we've been touching on, because this has been very, very interesting to I and I as we look at this particular document again, the royal parchment of royal parchment scroll, Yukrita, of Black Supremacy, the royal parchment scroll of Black Supremacy. And we also touch on Marcus Garvey, Marcus Messiah Garvey. I don't know if you have this particular video or if you've seen this particular video. This is a PBS, as you can see, it's a PBS DVD. This is a PBS DVD on Marcus Garvey. Isn't this amazing? A PBS DVD on Marcus Garvey and none on Haile Selassie and none on His Majesty. So you know this is a conspiracy. You gotta understand that. Why would they not even address His Imperial Majesty? If we see another video or film on Winston Churchill or Adolf Hitler, they don't even touch on Mussolini. Notice, they don't touch on, because they touch on Mussolini, they have to touch on His Imperial Majesty, Yovas. But instead of touching on His Imperial Majesty, you know what I mean? And historical films and documentaries that are talking about what happened on the world stage, and particularly for us as Black people at home and abroad, and even for the freedom of Africa, because they're not happy about it. They're happy about what's going on today in Africa because it gives them an opportunity, you understand, to go there as so-called do-gooders while we're sitting back talking about, oh, they want to just take over Africa. Well, what are we doing? You know, I mean, still marching, talking about no justice, no peace. You know what I'm saying? You know, in the land which is not your own land, and still don't want to recognize those elementals of biblical prophecy. But woe to Babylon. Now, Marcus Garvey, this video right here, I want you to check this out. You understand? If you haven't checked out, check it out again. And the reason why we put this video forward is because all the Garveyites and all those who are infatuated with Marcus Garvey and claim to be Rasta or maybe even Rastafari, you understand, and don't want to acknowledge the truth, they have a serious problem on their hands. Because it's like saying I'm a follower of John the Baptist and of Jesus Christ at one and the same time. You couldn't, because you see the fork in the road. At that fork in the road, you got to decide. This is what it means. You cannot have two masters. And this has been one of the things that has really retarded the progress of Rastafari on the local level, on the national level, region level, and the international level. Some folks are not going to like I and I for that, but I know this is a family program. We're not going to tell you what we think about if you don't like us for speaking that particular truth. But you got to check out this particular video. When you get an opportunity, please check out this particular video. Now, we're getting a little warning here. We're running a little bit low on our battery power. We didn't want to, like, break it up, you know, break up this recording like that. But check out the Marcus Garvey video, because it has a lot to do with the cord. Yeah. Let's just see if we can go through. If this cuts off, we'll continue. We'll continue this in a second part. But we just have to seek to plug this in. Give us a moment. You know, this is not scripted out. The only script for us is the scripture. You understand? The only script for us is the scripture. You know, this is just keeping it. Yeah, all right. We're still there? All right. Yeah, so let's just continue with it. So you got to check out this video right here. Marcus Garvey, the UNIA, the history and the so-called, it says, and toward black nationhood. You understand? And they give Marcus Garvey a video. It's on PBS. And we've been waiting for that particular video. We saw a clip of it with the royal grandsons, you know, the royal grandsons of His Imperial Majesty, the flesh and blood grandson, as we are the spirit, you understand, and blood of Christ, children of His Majesty. But they were doing some video for His Majesty, or at least it was like projected to be coming by sometime, or but we haven't seen nothing about it. But it's a conspiracy why Garvey has a video and His Majesty doesn't. You understand? And why His Majesty is avoided. You know, it's a conspiracy, a media blackout. You understand? And some of y'all still don't get it. You understand? If Garvey was so pro Haile Selassie, why would they have him? And if that's so, then that should link to Haile Selassie. It only links to Haile Selassie in the sense of some rastas, nowadays rastas. But let's look at some older documentation, the parchment scroll of black supremacy, and this, the promise key. Now, they said that this, by Reverend Fitz Ballantyne Petersburg, led to this by Leonard Percival Howell, or Ganganguru Mara, was another, you could say, pen name or moniker that he used when he wrote. And this is the picture of that brother who was martyred for His Imperial Majesty's sake because of his true witness of His Imperial Majesty. Now, in this document that we touched on in the previous video, and we said that we would take a little more time to go through it, we noticed something in this chapter, chapter 17. Chapter 17 is entitled Speaking in Tongues. And the portion of it that we point your attention to is where it says, in 1922, I told Judge Rutherford he must stop preaching lies. The Apostle Paul called them principality. Then it says, period, full stop. Then it says, the pilot Marcus Garvey, period, full stop. Pilot Marcus Garvey, right? The pilot Marcus Garvey. The fallen angel whose name is Lady Astonishment. Period, full stop. Then it says, she told Pilot Garvey, comma, that her big universal name is the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League. Now, here's something that we, you know, that we've noticed and we tried to touch on in the last part, but we probably got off on a little related but different subject matter, that at this particular time, there were leaders. Well, not even leaders, they didn't look at them, they were leaders and guides, but they were just brothers and sisters out there putting out the truth and bearing witness, true witness, to Haile Selassie, or at least to Rastafari, to our kinsman redeemer. While Garvey has gotten the fame for it, you understand, or has been assumed to be the prophet, so-called, and I find that to be offensive, because what prophecy did he particularly give? Even John the Baptist denied being the prophet in that sense. John the Baptist was just saying he's just a voice crying, calling in the wilderness, you know, prepare ye the way. You know, he denied, you know, those things. So how is it that you call him the prophet? I look at him more like John the Baptist in the sense that, yes, through his proclamation, many who had heard already, or some who didn't hear, but a lot of people already knew to look to Ethiopia. And this is one example right here, around the same time as, from a reverend, Fitz Ballantyne Petersburg, just like Reverend James Morris Webb, or there's another document, I think we have it right here, which is by Reverend Sterling M. Means. And that document is called Ethiopia, the Missing Link in African History. Now, these are Christian Africans, many of them African-American, but black Christian reverends and preachers and clergymen who, in studying their Bible and watching and praying and studying world events and history, they looked to Ethiopia and saw that prophetic sign fulfilled there. And they were proclaiming the message of look to Ethiopia and the message of we as Ethiopian Hebrews. While they were bringing the identity of us as Ethiopian, it was this Negro here, Garvey, who wanted to continue to call the people Negro. In other words, that would have been a step back. It's almost like, which is a more proper name for I and I, for us? Ethiopians, Hebrews, Rastafari, or niggers? See, niggers is only used as a byword, you understand? But he chose to call the organization the Universal Negro Improvement, you know, Improvement Association. But what's interesting is this interpretation. Ones have keep talking about black supremacy, but right here in this particular document, it says that the pilot, Marcus Garvey, the fallen angel whose name is Lady Astonishment, that's Revelation right there where John, not John the Baptist, but John the Revelator, he was looking upon this woman, that woman who sat on the beast and the many waters and everything in Revelation, and he wondered in great astonishment, and the angel said, why are you in astonishment? Don't you see the bloodshed in her? Don't you see her wickedness? And that's what the angel opened John the Revelator's eyes concerning about. But even John, he wondered in great wonderment or astonishment, depends on the translation that you're reading, when he looked at this woman. So here in Reverend Fitz's work, he says that the pilot, Marcus Garvey, the fallen angel, whose name is Lady Astonishment, she told pilot Garvey that her big universal name is the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League, period. What is this saying? you have to read this and meditate on this for yourself. And I saw this, and I'm not giving just a conclusion, but we are inclined, based on the evidence, to be of the let's say opinion. Some people say this is our opinion. We're gathering more and more evidence, and the evidence is showing us that this is true. This is the only rightful interpretation. To interpret this as saying that ones like Reverend Fitz, as well as even Reverend James Morris Webb, he began to recognize something's wrong with Garvey. You understand? Marcus Garvey prevented Reverend James Morris Webb from preaching and proclaiming Rastafari in the latter times before he got caught on the whole embezzlement and the bogus business charges and people losing their life saving, believing in his Black Star Liner idea, his version or perversion of a much older plan and scheme that was already in the hearts and minds of black people for years. Basically, with Garvey, a lot of that progressive activity, he was like a dissembler. A lot of that was lost. Now, I know a lot of folks who continue to say they love Garvey, blah, 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 blah. That's great. All I'm here to do is to bring you evidence, bring you some other information, ask you honestly to look at these things, to pray on these things. And we love Garvey as a black man, and in that sense, as a, quote, brother black man on that sort of limited level. But when it comes to Rastafari and His Imperial Majesty, we must be very, very careful. Remember the word that we cannot have two masters. You understand? You cannot be a Baptist following John the Baptist and be a Christian. Now, I know people say, but there's Baptist Christians today. Ain't that part of the problem? Think about it. Who are they following, Jesus or John? What did John do? John got offended. And after John got offended, he started to deny. What kind of great confusion? If this is the man that God sent, and if God truly sent you, and you're declaring this, why are you denying this? Or you're asking, are you the one that we're to look for? Not because of your personal situation. So John the Baptist allowed his personal situation to influence his mission, and therefore, in a fellow preacher's eyes like Reverend Fitz, he would be like a fallen angel. But now it goes on to say that the pilot believed the angle it has here in Ross Miguel Lawrence's version of this. It says, that the pilot, Marcus Garvey, he believed the Anglo-militant upside-down queen. Now, if you know the later history of Garvey, this makes this particular document extremely more interesting. And I don't think it's the way that a lot of Rastas who had probably looked at this book before but never really studied it in context of the history have looked at it. But this makes this document even more, in a sense, condemning of Garvey's betrayal of his Imperial Majesty. And these brothers were already seeing it from such a time. And part of the testimony is the memorialization in a document such as this. How can we interpret this any different, that the pilot believed the Anglo-militant upside-down queen? Who is the upside-down queen? Think about it. The five-pointed star is what? It is the feminine symbol in that system of symbology. And when you turn it upside down, it's turning womanhood, it's turning motherhood, or even turning nature. It's like when you tamper with nature, that's how you create nuclear bombs, atomic bombs, you know, a lot of other deadly things by tampering, polluting nature, turning nature upside down. So when we saw this right here, we had to ask ourselves, well, was this written before Garvey was deported? Then we find out that Garvey was deported in November of 27, around then, November 1927. Now, this has a dating. This has a dating on it. Let's go back to the dating. And this is why they opposed this movement so violently. You understand, this early, we could say Rastafari, this early Ethiopian Hebrew movement in the Americas and in the Caribbean and in Jamaica, this is why they oppose it so violently. This is the reason why they, and so as soon as the people started thinking of Garvey as a great hero, they went for it. You understand, because they know as soon as you say, yes, Garvey, they'll point out, well, how come Garvey says this and that, so forth and so on, where Garvey, even he praises the British system of things. He was a Roman Catholic. You understand? That's very serious, not just because it's about religion, but he was saying one thing but actually practicing something else. He praised the black shirts, you understand, the fascist black shirts who were killing and maiming and massacring innocent Ethiopian black men, women, and children. Because what? He was upset because he felt like, you know, he dressed up. He liked to play dress up. He felt that he was a chief, a general, so forth and so on. But he was too arrogant to even take responsibility. Now, it's interesting that His Majesty would not meet with Garvey, but would meet with other African-Americans and other black people. But a lot of that truth, the media and other agent provocateurs and dissemblers, they suppress that information. So only now, in this present time, with Daniel's prophecy being fulfilled, information, they shall go to and fro, information and knowledge shall be increased, and now we're able to have access to a lot of things that we only heard about, and to really read and study certain documents for ourselves, it becomes very clear. You remember this documentary? If you watch it, it talks about in the first part of it, there was some white girl that he used to play with, somebody, some relation back in Jamaica, so forth and so on. And when the father did not want Marcus Garvey to play with this white, he was infatuated by this white girl. It's interesting that all of a sudden he would come to America, you understand, and become this so-called blazing, so-called black nationalist, right? But see, what you're missing is what ones like Reverend Fitz and the Parchment Scroll, the Royal Parchment Scroll of Black Supremacy, what he caught on to. And this chapter, I know there's probably more in this, but these are just some of the basic facts, right? So this was written or allegedly published in 26, a year before Garvey. You understand? A year before Garvey. Remember, by this time, he had already demonstrated his enmity to Prince Rastafari. He already demonstrated his enmity, because what happened was that the UNIA, was what Garvey established, right? But these brothers were in favor of Ethiopia and Ethiopianist organizations. They were in favor of not being called Negroes anymore or niggers anymore, because now we had discovered our hidden identity. We had discovered that a part of that story that wasn't told to us. We discovered our name as Ethiopian. This is why it says in this particular area that she, who is she? Lady Astonishment. Who is Lady Astonishment? She's the upside down queen. Who is the upside down queen? That's Mystery Babylon. Whether you interpret that as the Freemasonic system, or whether as the Catholic Church, those three dirty frogs that are all part of it, basically, is Mystery Babylon is the most plausible interpretation of Mystery Babylon within the sense of a localization of that from the time of Rome, from Roman Empire to the so-called Holy Roman Empire to Catholicism to where we're at in this present time. Now, she told the pilot Garvey, who was to pilot this movement away to get us shipwrecked. So this shows how not so much the Rastafari movement, because it's always been this freedom of speech and freedom of expression among Ionized Rastafari who know the truth, because there's many others who have been trying to get this word out even before I, and we really would have hoped that we had heard the message more clearly, because we could have saved a lot of wasted time. You understand? A lot of wasted time trying to combine, people trying to combine Garveyism with the teaching of his imperial master. Those two are incompatible. They are incompatible. You understand? One with the other. If John pointed to Christ as the Lamb of God, then now we got to go to the Lamb of God. Thank you very much, John. We are with the Lamb of God. We can't be saying, well, we're following the Lamb of God, but remember, John is the one that pointed us, so we got to follow him too. That's confusion. That's confusion. And if we look at the challenges that face the movement, these are some of the initial weeds that need to be weeded out, or this is the beam, in a sense, that's in the Rasta eye. Marcus Garvey has become like the beam that's preventing us from really seeing and grasping the true gospel and message of His Majesty. And this is not to say, and let's just repeat this, make no mistake about this, we love Marcus Garvey. We're very upset with what he said. You understand? We hope he repented somewhere down the line. I hope the Almighty had mercy on him and forgave him. But still, for us to now put Marcus Garvey in proximity to His Majesty and before the true proclaimers of Rastafari, I don't know if they have a name for that crime. I don't know. Is it treason? It's a little bit more. Is it blasphemy? It's such a complicated crime, but it's definitely criminal. It's definitely evil. It's confusion. That's what it is, my brothers and sisters. But the purpose of this particular reasoning is that, like we said, we was going over the Royal Parchment Scroll of Black Supremacy and just reading through it, and we came to chapter 17, and we saw the pilot Marcus Garvey, and then it said the fallen angel whose name is Lady Astonishment. And then we said, well, we've read this before, we think, but let's read this again. She told pilot Garvey that her big universal name is the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League. Now notice something. These brothers, such as Reverend Fitz and Leonard Percival Howell, and Reverend Sterling M. Means, and Reverend James Morris Webb, and others, they were vigorously and courageously and boldly adopting the name and favoring the name Ethiopia. There were two sets of organizations at that time, nigger and Negro organizations, and there were Ethiopian organizations. Those were the real progressive organizations. But see, if the pilot had continued to pilot the ship rightly and righteously, we would have done reached our shores already by now, and His Majesty would not have to say next time send the right people. he would not have had to say that, because people were coming there totally confused. And this is the same thing that plagues even the Rastafari and certain Pan-African movements to this day. You see, Garvey is a part of our history, Yovas, but Garvey is not His Imperial Majesty. And Garvey was offended in His Imperial Majesty. And therefore, for His Majesty's sake, we must be offended in him and take him down from that parody with His Imperial Majesty, because we cannot serve two masters and be called and faithful and true and most of all, overcome. You understand? Overcome in this time. It's a self-delusion on that. I'm sure there's probably more in here about Garvey, but this is our interpretation. What's yours? Check it out for yourself, and we'll return and talk about something more with this, or probably move on from this. But this was the basic matter that we wanted to share. We didn't go through a big scripting out. We still have some Torah portion readings and feeding and some other things to share with you in due time. So, brothers and sisters, Shalom Rastafari once again. Watch and pray.